Now, on Rolling Hot, Denver Fire.
So we're at the school today, giving a tour for Fire Prevention Week.
Word reaches Captain Helwick of a medical emergency inside the school building. Engine 26 and truck 26 respond to a kitchen fire in an apartment complex. And the crew of truck 26 rolls on a potentially deadly carbon monoxide call. Serving the Stapleton and East Park Hill neighborhoods stands Denver Fire Department's Station 26. It is home to Truck 26, an aerial ladder truck under the command of A Company's Lieutenant John Padilla. And Engine 26, commanded by Captain Carly Helwick. One of the missions of the Denver firefighters is community outreach and education. Today, Captain Helwick and the crew of Engine 26 leave to visit a preschool and kindergarten in the neighborhood.
So we're at the school today, giving a tour for Fire Prevention Week.
Oh, good. Thanks for coming by to us. Hey, our pleasure.
So before we see the fire truck,
does everybody in this room sit in a booster seat and wear their seatbelts? In a car seat or booster seat? Raise your hand if you're in a car seat or a booster seat.
I grew up in the fire service. My dad is a firefighter. He was hired when I was a year old. I'm pictured at his graduation. I was 1 year old. And I grew up in the fire service. I remember just different firemen that were like uncles and like second uncles. It was like an extended family. It was fantastic. I feel very privileged to have grown up in the fire service.
Never ever forget to wear your seatbelt. Ever, 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 ever.
So firefighters are gonna wear two uniforms, okay? I'm wearing one, right? I got my badge. And I wear all blue, so if you see us, this is one uniform that we wear, okay? And then we also have another uniform that we wear, and Luke's gonna put it on for us. Mm-hmm. And that's one that we wear when we're around really hot stuff, okay? Or if something's on fire. And we wanna show you guys what that looks like, okay? So while he starts to put that on, and this is Firefighter Luke.
Hi.
It's a fun event to go out and kind of show your fire truck off and all the gear that we wear to all the school children and help them to not be afraid of firefighters.
Okay, do we get under tables when our house is on fire?
No.
Do we get under our bed and cover our face with a blanket? No, okay? But we know we don't hide anywhere. But I wanna show you what Firefighter Luke's gonna look like, because fire and smoke can be scary, right? So we're gonna show you what he looks like so that if you do need help, and you see him and he comes into your house or any place where there's smoke or fire or you're super scared, he's gonna show you what he looks like and what he sounds like so you can yell out to him and he can help you, okay? And then you guys can tell me after he puts on everything if you think he looks scary, okay? All right.
So I have a big coat on, just like you get in the winter coat if you're gonna go outside in the snow. And I have a hood on to keep my warm and my ears safe.
So it's neat to see their faces, and as I'm putting my gear on, you can see some kids who begin to get nervous. And then as our fellow crew members keep talking to them and keep reminding them that we're the same people, whether all of our gear is on or not.
Still Luke, do you guys see him? He's okay. He's not going to make any loud noises, okay?
All right. Audrey, it's okay.
He's not going to make any loud noises.
Audrey, yes, it's okay.
Okay. What he's going to do is he's going to turn on this pack back here, guys. And why do you think he has this big backpack on? Let him stand up. Why do you think he has this? To breathe fresh air, because we have to go where it's smoky. So he's going to turn this on, and there's going to be a couple beeps. Okay? Go ahead. Okay? Not bad, right? There's the beeps. Now he's going to go on that air, and he's going to show you what he sounds like, okay? Okay? What do you think? Can you still see Luke in there? You still see him?
Yeah.
Yeah? Oh. Now how does he sound? Let's listen to him.
Does that sound
kind of
funny?
Does that sound funny? Yeah, he does.
And then once they come up and touch the gear, you can see the smiles on their faces and kind of the fear go away. So it's a real neat experience.
He did sound funny to me. Yeah. I think he might sound extra funny because it's just firefighter Luke sounding funny.
Hi, how are you? Ready? This is like a good little
shoulder,
it's like doing curls over down. Here. Ready?
Every time.
Say
you need it, firefighter Matt.
I have three kids at home. I have an 8-year-old, a 2-year-old, and a newborn, which is 2 weeks old today. You know, anybody who works shift work, and especially firefighters, they're at work a third of their lives. So we work a day, we're off for 2 days, and the cycle repeats. So there's lots of birthdays, kids' birthdays you miss. There's holidays that you miss. But I think, you know, with the 2 days being off, you know, it makes up for some things. There's a lot of days that you get off that other parents don't get, so you can go to more school functions maybe. But definitely I think the hardest part is missing a third of your kids' lives and you're away from your family for 1 out of every 3 days.
While showing off Engine 26, word reaches Captain Helwick of a medical emergency taking place inside the school building.
Thank you.
Somebody hurt?
Yeah.
A couple of us went in. Party inside had what was thought to be a diabetic emergency. And tended to the patient while we were waiting for the ambulance.
Except it's one of the greatest things that I think that we bring to any of these emergency scenes. Just the calm. You know, people need that. There's chaos going on for them. It's very emotionally charged for them. It's easy for us to not get caught up in the emotions of the scene, or at least it's easier for me to separate myself from it because we have a job to do. We do have something to do on those scenes. It's a car accident, it's a rollover, an industrial accident, even if it's CPR. We have a job to do there. Since we have it, we have something to focus on, and so emotionally we don't get too attached to what's happening. Some of those things that we're able to take that, and what's more, the emotional side happens here back here at the firehouse when we kind of get together and talk about some of the things we've seen, and you know, the human body is a pretty nice thing because if it's too traumatic for you to even be able to process what you're seeing, the details become very fuzzy.
Found her blood pressure to be normal, her heart rate was normal. We didn't have the tools with us to assess her blood glucose, something we don't carry on the Denver Fire Department, something that the paramedics do carry. So we pretty much made sure the patient had an airway open and was breathing and was able to talk to us while the ambulance was responding.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
Good.
How are you?
Good.
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 Denver uses a two-tiered approach to emergency medical calls. Denver Fire usually providing first response, and Denver Health providing advanced life support and transportation. The firefighters briefed the Denver Health paramedics and remain to assist them until the patient, a staff member of the school, is transported.
Some of that quite frequently. Very rarely does it happen at the same location you're at. So the outcome, the patient is transported to the hospital for evaluation.
Engine 26 returns to service, ready for the next call.
I got into fire service pretty young. I was 19 at the time when I was in college up in Greeley and became a volunteer up there. But even younger than that, I grew up, my father's a firefighter, so it was nice to follow in his footsteps. And even as a young kid, I would go to the fire station and play on fire trucks and ride along with him. So something I knew pretty young that it was a career path I wanted to look into.
It wasn't like this, you know, when I was six, I was like, I'm going to be a firefighter. Honestly, I was kind of stuck into the stigma of, that's my dad's job. That's a dad's job. I'd say it was a slower progression. I met my husband young, and I can remember when he made it his goal to become a firefighter. For me, it was a slower progression. It was kind of a realization. I was always a tomboy. My dad always pushed getting involved. Don't stand on the sidelines. So I was big into sports. And after my husband and I had our son, it really kind of put things in perspective of how I wanted to raise a family and what I wanted that life to look like. And also it had to do a lot with getting to know myself and where my personality really fit in. And so that's when it became kind of, I guess, when life got a little bit more realistic, because I think I went into college prior to having my son and I'm like, I'm going to be a psychologist or I'm going to become a doctor, not really fully understanding that's 8 years of school of my life. And when you have a son, I kind of kept it to the side until I really looked at how I wanted to live my life. And that's when it really became apparent that the fire department was, especially in Denver, with my dad, it really became the goal that I wanted to achieve.
For me, it was quite a bit harder to get a paid job than I thought it was gonna be. I thought once I graduated college and I was ready for a paid job, I could just call up and say, hey dad, I'm ready for a job. It worked out that wasn't the case, but I think it worked out for the better. He and I work on different ends of town. He's up north for a suburb department. And so it's nice to be able to make my own footprint and not be, you know, so-and-so's son on the fire department. So other than that, I mean, it's pretty much what I expected growing up. I think, you know, there's certain things you see on calls that are mentally more challenging than I expected. But it's a great career to have. I love helping people, and I really love that every day is a different day at work.
Engine 26 and Truck 26 respond with other units to a call of a kitchen fire in an apartment complex. Engine 26 is the second unit in after Engine 10 and has pulled the hydrant to supply additional water if needed.
So our responsibility for backup the first.
When we arrived, it's our responsibility to ensure that that first engine company has all the water that's going to need.
Small kitchen fire.
Pardon?
Small kitchen fire.
Small kitchen fire.
Hot on fire. It's impressive. Denver has an awesome response. You have so many crews on scene within less than 4 minutes usually. We're all here.
Even though you hear, hey, this is a pot on fire, you've always got to be prepared for somebody knocked the pot over. Maybe it's a full kitchen now. And what is always the next step? It's a responsibility as a company officer to always have that next step in mind because you don't want to get caught not being prepared.
Yeah, well, so like our company came up, they grabbed additional hose lines off of this.
Oh.
And we park our rig at the hydrant to augment the water supply for these guys.
So Engine 10 basically headed out by the time we got here. So all the crews are done and we're ready to go.
Back in service, get ourselves in service, and we'll be ready for the next one.
Truck 26 has picked up and is back in service, ready for the next call.
Truck 26, respond to a carbon monoxide or inhalation problem. Truck 26, respond to a carbon monoxide. Truck 26, respond to a carbon monoxide or inhalation problem.
Truck 26 got dispatched on a call. We were going on a medical alarm. The lady had activated her medical alarm, and she was saying that she was having CO. So there was a little confusion at first. We arrived on scene, and she confirmed that.
I came to the kitchen because it sounded like the oven. So when I came to the kitchen, but then it was like, next thing I know, it said carbon monoxide. So when I went back to try to see where it was coming from, and I didn't understand. And then when I went, I said, what? I said, oh, I thought it was a smoke detector. So then I came back, so I said, well, I pushed my medical alert. So I pushed the medical alert. And they said, Miss Pullen, are you all right? I said, no. I said, can you send somebody out here? Because I got an alarm saying, it's saying carbon monoxide. But then they thought like it was with my health. I said, that's the same thing as health. No, I didn't have no seizure or nothing. But that's the same thing as my health. Carbon monoxide, that's deadly. Very deadly.
Indeed.
Yes, sir.
You did the right thing.
I know I did. And also, I grabbed my dog, took a sip of beer.
Hey.
That's sugar.
So we took our meters inside, and what we found is levels as high as 65 parts per million, which are enough to certainly find some discomfort, and over time it's going to create some more issues for her health.
I got some carbon monoxide in.
You have a little bit of exposure to it, because how long has it
about 7-18 minutes.
Okay, and that's the thing too, we don't know.
Go and relax your hand, that's fine.
How long it's been an issue?
It's just, that's for some, yeah, but I'm just saying, but okay. But like last week, for a whole week, okay. I kept having headaches.
Have you been home all day today, Miss?
I left today. I won't go for too long because my son took me to the store.
So when you came back, how long have you been here since you left?
About seven, eight hours.
Okay. And so like I said, long exposure, it takes a while, so if it was, I just got back an hour ago, and we're having some complications, I'd be more concerned, I'd call the ambulance. But right now, this is all expected. The exposure to the fresh air is already helping you. You're not having any complaints or any difficulties, so that's why we use this to check and see if you're progressing, and you are. So that's a good thing. Yeah, you betcha. So we're at
90%.
Yeah. So all the levels are coming up, and it's good now at that point.
Yeah,
0.5.
Yeah.
Hello.
It's going down.
Yeah. So Miss Will, that's what I can say. All it is outside of that environment, fresh air,
hello.
Body's coming back. And now that problem's not going to occur because we turn off the gas to the meter,
okay.
Or to the hot water heater. Okay. But I want to take you down there before we leave, so you can see exactly what we're talking about. And then we'll have you on your way, and you should be fine.
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Okay. Perfect.
Yeah, that's going down. Good way, Johnny.
All right. Great. Yeah. A little fresh air will do it to you every time. We isolated the leak to her hot water heater. The flue coming out from there isn't properly installed, so there's a portion where it sags, and that's where it's leaking.
Whoever it is, it doesn't exhaust right. Because like you said, you're supposed to
cover. Tell the owner.
Yeah, yes. So that's basically tell them that this right here is where, you know, there's a couple ways they can take care of it, you know, but they basically just have to make this vent properly, which means a quarter inch of rise per foot.
So the remedy was to turn it off, but in such a tight area, what we have to do is ventilate. Putting her outside the environment has created her to feel a little bit better, getting the fresh air, and once we dissipate all of that area, we've isolated it. She's informed the owner of the home to get that repaired, and that's what's going to happen. As soon as we have the ventilation, we'll check with the homeowner, and we should be back in service.
There are an average of over 400 unintentional non-fire-related deaths from carbon monoxide each year in the United States. Carbon monoxide detectors save lives.
Engine 26, truck 26, respond to an auto accident with injury.